गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, नमस्कार। माय नेम इज रवि गुप्ता एंड आई एम सीईओ एंड फाउंडर ऑफ इलेट्स टेक्नोमीडिया प्राइवेट लिमिटेड। इलेट्स इज एन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन व्हिच इज 17 ईयर ओल्ड एंड वी हैव बीन ब्रिंगिंग आउट अ मैगजीन कॉल्ड ईगव व्हिच इज इंडियाज एंड एशियाज फर्स्ट एंड ओनली मैगजीन ऑन ई गवर्नेंस। एंड वी हैव बीन डॉक्यूमेंटिंग एंड डिसमिनेटिंग द आइडियाज ऑफ इनोवेशन इन द गवर्नेंस इकोसिस्टम। टुडे वी आर proud to have with us Shri Kunal Kumar, who is an IAS officer of the 1999 batch of the Government of India, and he is a Maharashtra cadre officer. Presently, he is a joint secretary and mission director of Smart City Mission, Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Government of India, and he was earlier the municipal commissioner of Pune for 4 years, where he has been known for a lot of initiatives on smart cities. I welcome Shri Kunal Kumar ji on this webinar and thank you for joining us.
Namaskar. Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Ravi, for the introduction. I'm very happy to be part of this because I think in a time like the one we are in right now, the best thing we can do is to learn from each other, to be agile in the actions that we take on ground. So my intention here would be to actually share some stories of what is happening in our city so that people who are on the job can make some difference if it helps them in some way.
Sure. So in these challenging times, how are smart cities rising to the occasion? How are they helping the citizens? That is one of the key discussion points today. So before we do that, I'm going to ask Kunal Kumar that Smart Cities mission is about developing 100 Indian cities with huge investment in terms of making them more agile, more efficient. So please explain about the current progress of the mission.
We used to talk about numbers before the COVID crisis, and suddenly now we're talking about other things. But since you are asking the numbers, I think 80% of the projects that we had taken in as part of our smart city plans in 100 cities have started, have got tendered. And close to 60% of the works are actually happening on ground. When I say actually happening on ground, of course, some of them are stalled due to the current condition. But that's good movement in a short time. Because we should remember that even though the mission was launched in 2015, selection of cities went on till 2018. So the window of actual work has been very much less than actually what we feel is 5 years, because 5 years is the announcement and the selections have happened later. So that's the current status, but we should not only talk about the numbers. Look at the kind of work that they have done. We never talked of complete streets. We did talk about roads in the past, but we didn't talk about complete streets. We talked about buses and roads, but we didn't talk about mobility. We talked about pipes and water storage systems, but we didn't talk about water to home. And then look at the way they have started to use technology, whether it is ICCs, whether it is different kinds of e-governance solutions which make a difference to citizens' lives. So these are things which are new beginnings in the Indian context, and it was only possible because of the Smart Cities mission ambition to actually look at these new areas of work. So as we stand today, the best testimony of how Smart Cities have progressed would actually come from how they have responded to the current crisis. Because an army which is good on paper has no meaning if it goes to a war and collapses immediately. So I think this army, people used to debate whether it is good on paper or not, but they are certainly not debating whether it's good at war. It has proved itself at war, and it is proving itself every day. And by no means the war is over, but it only shows that they are ready for it, and they're actually saying that goes. As the going gets tough, the tough gets going. Smart cities have lived up to that saying. Yeah.
Yeah. if you can talk about that, how are the smart cities responding in these times of the COVID-19 situation when there is a huge crisis and the city administration is burdened with a lot of handling of the emergency situation like a lockdown and also the health pandemic. So how are they able to use that investment which has been done in the building of the smart city infrastructure?
So Ravi, instead of giving you a long list of things, it always becomes easy to remember and encapsulate when we put it into some boxes. Sure. I'll put this into four boxes, which I call the four quadrant approach that smart cities have adopted. And the first quadrant is information. And all of us know it's so important to be aware of what is happening on the ground. What is happening in which zones of the city? Where is the disease spreading? What are the tests showing? What is the availability of beds? What is the availability of paramedics, of doctors, of nurses? Mm-hmm. You need to deal with a lot of information processing. So that's the first quadrant where technology has been used. And let us not think of technology only as digital technology or IoT. You know, even a simple chair or a table, or I'm just saying in the most metaphorical way, are all examples of technology. So when I'm saying technology, I'm actually meaning the larger domain of solutions. So that information is one. The second is communication, you know, and this is two-way communication from the city to tell the people what is fact, what is a rumor, to talk to people about, you know, what is happening in the city, to make them aware about each thing about the doubts they may have, the questions they may have, where are the testing centers, where are the cases happening, what is it that my city is prioritizing, where can I go, where I cannot go, what are the essential services permitted, how do I get passes. So it's two-way communication. Citizens can also talk to the city officers and get their problems solved, whether it's health problems or any other problems. And city can also give a lot of information. The third quadrant is about management. And this includes your health management as well as what you talked about, which is lockdown management. Mm-hmm. It's the human angle, it's the economic angle, it's the migrant angle, it's the health angle. Everything needs to be managed. And there is a lot of coordination which comes for management. So management also includes a lot of coordination which is required between police, health, labor departments, and so on and so forth. Fourth quadrant is again the prediction quadrant, which is the preparedness quadrant. Which is where cities are trying to be prepared for the future. You are fighting a war today, but this war is pretty much unknown to you, how it's going to shape in the future, what are the different kinds of things that you would need. Of course, you have some reasonable knowledge, and therefore you plan. For example, if you are able to predict using data as to how much number of cases and where in your city geographically those cases will be located, then you can plan your health infrastructure, you can plan your equipment, resources, manpower, everything accordingly to be able to meet that challenge going forward. So if it's showing clearly that 3 months down the line, the number of beds in your city is going to fall short, then you would start augmenting now. So just remember the four quadrants. I think I keep talking to my team, I talk to the smart cities, and it comes out that all the initiatives they're taking fall in these four quadrants of information, communication, management, and preparedness. So that's how it is.
We have all heard about the IECCC you just mentioned, and for our listeners, like IECCC stands for Integrated Command and Control Centers. They are considered one of the most important piece of the smart city deployment. How have IECCC been able to be useful in this critical situation? If you can explain about that.
So, I think time has come that we redefine a name for the IECCs. Integrated Command and Control looks like it is a police entity or something which is there to manage a crisis all the time, and or manage an event like managing an Olympics or something. I think the better name now that it has earned for itself because of its work during the crisis is a integrated community center. And I think going forward from IECCC, it becomes IECCC, which is Integrated Community Center. because it has actually worked with the community, for the community, and it has been actually actuated by the community. I've seen overnight, in fact, talk the example of, say, Bangalore. 23rd March, overnight, they put up the war room and they started working on how to manage the crisis from that war room, deployed about 20-25 people and started to look at every small nuance of how the thing is spreading. And see how the ICCC can be used. And again, go back to those four quadrants, you know, information gathering, for example. So the cities have deployed a bouquet of apps. Now here again, you know, because it is an agile situation, it's theoretically very nice to talk about one integrated app. And that can happen in the long term. But when you're quickly tomorrow or today, you are supposed to deal with the crisis, you look at whatever is possible. So there are multiplicity of things which happen and they're bound to happen. But the ICCC enables the integration of all the data that comes from those apps into one single, the ICCC layer. Okay. So that's one part of it. The second part is about the communication, as I talked about. So even the call centers, chatbots, social media handles, Facebooks, WhatsApps, all these, in fact, if you see, Bangalore, in fact, became a case study which went global of how it used WhatsApp for service delivery and essential commodities to citizens. So it became the aggregator. The Bangalore Mahanagar Palika became the aggregator. Mm-hmm. And orders started to come to that WhatsApp number and then subsequently got relayed to commodity providers who then met the need. Then you see COVID tracker apps and teleconference solutions, telemedicine solutions, volunteering solutions, NGOs volunteering for things. So these are all parts of the communication angle. And also on the third thing that I talked about, the management angle. So everything on the input side, these are all happening on the ground and capturing data in various ways. And these are now getting integrated to the ICCC. Once they get integrated, you know, the plan for the, let's say you have six dedicated hospitals for COVID. So the data comes in and you know that in the six hospitals, in the morning we had 70 beds and the afternoon we have now 62 beds. So then you start to look at your predictive model and say that, well, going forward, I need 80. So there is a gap of 18, which I need to create. So this kind of thing in management started to become possible. And then, of course, the predictive modeling bit is very important. As I said, it's helping cities become aware of their needs in the future. Surveillance. Now, surveillance is not in the wrong way. In fact, there is a lot of debate about surveillance. And I'm one of those who are very cautious when I use those terms. I think trust with the community is not built by a word like surveillance. What we could call it is like, you know, you're trying to keep your eyes and ears on the ground through cameras and other methods of seeing what is happening. And for example, lockdown. You know, surveillance cameras are very useful when you are looking at a lockdown scenario and trying to maintain it. And you're also actually trying to see what's happening in different places. Now, sanitation, especially in slums, in vulnerable areas where people are living, those areas need a lot of focus. So sanitation also, you know, a lot of technology and otherwise also people looked at it. So in all these four quadrants, the ICCC has enabled a seamless linkage from the input side and a seamless linkage on the output side. So many cities are coming out with bulletins, which go to the cities, which come out directly from the dashboard. There are APIs of information which go directly to the, let's say, the police department, the health department. There are solutions where people, let's say, come in for telemedicine calls and those things get recorded and then you get a database of what kinds of troubles people are facing so that you can plan your health management accordingly. So input and output integration is happening through the ICCC, which is a real-time effort. And I'll also say that, you know, ICCC, let's not confuse with something that is a big room with a lot of gadgets and a lot of screens and crores of investment. The ICCC that I'm talking about in the COVID crisis are those which have a software on cloud and four or five computers, a couple of screens where you can actually use to let people visualize data. That's all. It's not even a few lakhs. And you can start up and running with the kind of approach that we've had within 24 hours. So that's the kind of approach we have taken, light on hardware, light on CapEx, and focused more on the solution. And by the way, we don't measure success by which app deployed, how much of data ingested. We measure success through KPIs, which are outcome oriented. How many people helped, how many kinds of equipment have been purchased. All the asks on the outcome side are reflected in the KPIs. And that's very important. And we are having a regular call every day with most cities. Bangalore War Room, I myself on a call every 9 p.m. and And we are now taking it to other cities. 17 cities have now events interest in the Bangalore solution. So we are taking it to 17 cities. And next week, or maybe even Friday, we are having a call with about 55 more cities. Hopefully they will then take over the solution. So a quickly deployable solution is now available for everyone to take care of. So we're not losing time on making solutions or hardware purchase, things like that. So entire bureaucratic red tape has been cut through. We're focused on saving lives and managing the crisis on ground.
Wow. This is amazing that a solution in a city like Bangalore, which has got deployed so fast, is being scaled up so fast to other cities. And that's the way I think a disaster-like situation has to be dealt with. Please tell us about that. What's your view on some of the ways in which smart cities have become adaptive to be more effective?
So, you know, one of the things I clearly can see what's happening in this crisis is that there has been a de jure. I can't say de facto, because de facto is by law. But de jure is what you see in practice. And in practice, there has been a lot of decentralization, much more than you have in normal times. So cities have been able to react quickly. So I think one of the things that we have to see going forward is how we can give more flexibility and freedom to local officers and cities to take action with, you know, agility when faced with this kind of. And by the way, COVID is a big example, surely much bigger than what we expect in normal times. But in normal times also, you face a lot of complex problems. The second thing I think is about the ways we finance infrastructure. And infrastructure, when I say infrastructure, I also mean health. I mean online education. I mean better schools for the underprivileged. I mean better affordable housing. You know, I mean good public transport. I mean good water, good sanitation. Now, to us seems like a unimaginable situation where we will get all the money to doing these things, because these things will definitely cost a lot of money. But look, public transport, for example. There are cities across the world who have done carbon tax, parking charges. So much of resistance you have in normal times to these things. Why can a private person park his car on the road free of cost? Why, if that can be done, well, you can also put your refrigerator or your furniture on the road, because how is a car different from a refrigerator? I don't understand. Both are private property. How do you get a right to put it on the road free of cost? So parking charges, congestion charges, and carbon tax kind of things can actually help you scale public transport. And this is something where I want to talk about a term which I use often, which is called access equality. I may be a person who has a Mercedes car and I can go from X to Y in, say, 20 minutes. But I may be having any amount of income. It doesn't, should not matter, because I should get good quality public transport to travel the same distance X and Y, maybe not in 20 minutes, but 25 minutes by a good quality public transport. So there is an example of this in private sector. I can, all of us use mobile phones. And if you see, mobile phones are there with the poorest of the poor and the richest of the richest. So it is an innovation. It is a product which has gone from all income groups. So why can't public transport or a good quality transport be available to all income groups? How can affordable housing be available to all income groups? So the innovations that will be needed will be to not only look at innovative solutions, but also look at innovative ways of financing them. How can you, say, finance water? Telescopic charges. Not many cities even now have metering. So how can you look at, you know, water meters where actually people pay as per use, and people who wash their cars or maybe gardens from water do end up paying slightly more, because that's the rational way of looking at things. Electricity does it very well. We don't mind paying in electricity. Why do we mind paying in solid waste management? Why do you mind paying in water? Because once these things start to happen, they will actually be able to fund themselves, and these will become the norm. Then, of course, you know, urban planning. You know, we have 10-year plans, and then we are always talking about dynamic planning. But what is dynamic planning? Now, dynamic planning is something easy to say, but very difficult to grasp. You know, in a very simple way, if I say, either a place can follow a plan or a plan can follow a place. If a place is following a plan, it is static planning. Somebody has created a blueprint and the place has to follow it. But the plan following the place is the dynamic plan, where the place is reorienting itself every day. You blink your eye, there is a new building. You blink your eye, there is a new industry. There are new workers. So when you see the place changing, if your plan can keep adapting to that place, it becomes a dynamic plan. So form-based planning, place-based planning, these are things which have to be immediately adopted. Lastly, I will also say, you know, one reform which I think is going to be very useful is how do you finance cities? Yes. It's not only about giving freedom. Right? It's, yes, give them freedom, give them decentralization, but there has to be accountability. And so financing has to chase outcomes. I will not finance, or maybe we should not finance. This is something we have to debate. When I'm saying I will, this is my personal opinion at the moment, but of course this will need a lot of debate within government. I think we should not finance projects. We should finance outcomes. We should finance education, not schools. We should finance mobility, not roads. We should finance water, not taps. And there's a huge difference. It's like, you know, the inputs are at one end of the pipe. What comes out are at the other end of the pipe. You have to finance things at the other end. So what, then what happens is people become more innovative. They look at different innovative ways of reaching the outcome. Otherwise, when you finance inputs, they will end up absorbing all the money, yet the final output doesn't come out. So these are some thoughts that we are looking at going forward. Not to say the least, all these things, whether planning, whether finance, everything will be based on the foundation of data. Unless you have, you know, good quality data, you will never be able to do all these things that I talked about. And let me not forget, a very, very important component is about how do you look after the vulnerable section. Because there is a segment of society which I think is completely got lost under the radar. And they are part of the economic engine. If you see a lot of construction sites, there are a lot of laborers who live there. Of course, they don't live now because they seem to have gone back. But those are places which have always gone under the radar because those are people who don't belong to the city. And of course, the political economy also you know, tends to look after their voters, so they don't fall in. Mm-hmm. They are in between somewhere.
Yes.
And the data about them is also lacking. So at least the city has to start with looking at data, looking at the system of supporting them. And all the money that will be required for this will have to come through these ingenious ways of financing, which I just talked about. So it's a collective social approach. You know, I was just seeing a headline today. Mohammed Yunus, this Bangladesh economist, says, it's not about reviving the economy going forward. It's about reimagining the economy going forward. Mm. And that's the thing that smart cities have to do.
Reimagining. And let me take that keyword of reimagining and ask you that what are the innovative steps being undertaken by the smart city mission with regards to environment, data and knowledge sharing, ease of living and municipal finance? Some of it, like you have already touched, but if you can detail out some others.
Of course, you know, we want to debate, we want to take the debate now from projects to ease of living. So, okay, you are a city, but how well are you doing on water? How well are you doing on mobility? How well are you doing on solid waste management? Okay, you're doing your projects, that's fine. I'm not bothered about your projects, but I'm more bothered about how it's impacting your outcomes. Okay. Number two, and this is the ease of living framework. Then we have launched what is called the municipal performance framework, where we are saying, look, if you're a municipal body and you want to be responsive to your citizens, you should come good on five pillars. It's governance, finance, services, planning, and technology. So you have to be good on these five pillars, and there will be a measurement method where you can use to self-assess yourself and assess against your peers where you stand in the country. Then the climate smart cities assessment is also something that we have initiated. One round completed last year. We are in the process of initiating the second round. We would have already done it, but we have now stopped because of this crisis. So cities will know how they are performing on climate. Climate, both adaptation as well as mitigation. Then the Data Smart Cities program is looking at building the foundation of working on data. Because even if you want to work on ease of living or climate, you need to have a control on how you understand the world of data. Because how do you know whether you have improved on mobility unless you understand what data to capture, how to assess it, and then how to, you know, go ahead and capture it further so that you are able to create a comparison. So I call it the primary education of every outcome-based work. Data is the primary education. You can't do a PhD unless you've done primary education, can you? So I think ease of living, climate smart cities kind of things are the PhDs, which are the outcomes, the impacts at the end of the tunnel. But you can't reach there unless you learn how to work with teams, how to collaborate, how to exchange data, how to break silos, how to be open in government, how to be able to create solutions along with your people, be innovative. And these are things that have to come, and they will come with more flexibility and freedom. So everything is connected. Decentralization leads to these things. These things, you know, promote decentralization, they get a lot of financing because then citizens' trust develops and all these things spiral into a virtuous cycle. So that is where we are. We are also starting a couple of programs which are very interesting. One program is, of course, last year, a couple of years back, we started the fellowship. So there are smart cities fellowship that we are doing to involve the youth. Now we are on the verge of starting an internship program across India. The fellowship is with the mission in Delhi, but the internship is across India with all the ULBs, urban local bodies, all the 4,400 cities will host internship programs where we will offer learning opportunities to graduates, fresh graduates, people who are 18 months post their graduation. Then, of course, we are also looking at building some kind of collaborative platforms for citizen volunteering and some kind of a system where we can acknowledge volunteering activities. Look, it is not about city needing someone to come and fix a pothole. Don't think of volunteering like that. But think of volunteering as learning by doing. You know, there are electrical engineering graduates, and I'm one of them. But who have done a master's in electrical engineering but don't know how to fix an electric bulb. So, you know, citizen volunteering is also about learning by doing small things, you know, fixing a small, registering a complaint, even voicing a concern, sharing a problem is a volunteering.
Sure.
So we are moving towards all that.
This is all, I think, citizen engagement initiative, which is like...
This is broader citizen engagement. One way of engaging is asking, look, what you want in the city. Exactly. And then you forget. Other is, you know, you actually make them participate. And then third is you actually work with them, which is volunteering, which is internships, which is, you know, co-creation and open innovation.
Yes.
Those are levels of citizen engagement that we have to scale gradually.
And I think participatory governance are...
Started with this idea, scaling these experiments, you know, looking at being lighthouses in the country and showing the way. I think that's the way forward.
Great. Please also talk about that our cities are leading from the front. How can we increase the capacity of our urban local bodies learning from the current crisis? And can you also elaborate on associating youth? Like you already talked about it, but capacity building is a big issue in the urban local bodies. If you can reflect upon it.
Well, I have started to think like this. Capacity will not lead to building. Building will lead to capacity. And I would elaborate on that. You know, when we talk about capacity building, we think that people will go to seminars, learn about things, and come back and implement them. And that is how they will build their capacity. But I would rather say they build something, they may fail, but they know that they have failed and they know how to improve it and they build it again. Through that, they build capacity. So I was saying building leads to capacity rather than capacity leading to building. And in any case, you know, in light humor, I may say when you have capacity building activities in beautiful conference rooms, the building becomes more prominent than the capacity because people come there, they spend a day or two and they go back. And so if you have to look at building capacity like that, then of course it will come through more and more experimentation on the ground. It will come through doing. It will not come through fascination with global best practices. It will not come through fascination with consultant advice, but it will come through your own doing, your own, you know, going out and trying to solve problems, problem solving. You know, how does a kid build capacity? Goes to grade 8, then goes to grade 9, then goes to grade 10, and so on. Capacity building is an iterative process. You can't really jump. If a consultant comes and tells a student in grade 8 some gyan in his ear, and automatically this person can do a PhD, it doesn't happen. He has to go through the grade 9, grade 10, and so on. So we are looking at more peer-to-peer learning, and we are looking at championing people, local solutions, local champions, and how they can be, you know, scaled up across the country. So the National Urban Learning Program, which we're trying to create, is essentially that. It's about you being a prosumer of capacity. What is a prosumer? Somebody is a producer and somebody is a consumer, right? In the normal world. But a prosumer is you are both a consumer and a producer. You are doing something good, you can share with people. You're not doing something good, you can learn from somebody else. So you are a consumer as well as a producer. So we're looking at those kinds of concepts in what we are currently calling the Rashtriya Shahri Shabda Nirman Karyakram. But we're in the process of building something like that very actively in the future. Yeah.
Fantastic. And like as the COVID situation is evolving and we are all seeing it daily, what are the challenges you are seeing in the next few months for our cities to be prepared for?
Well, I think, as I said, we'll have to reimagine the way we'll make cities. Cities are fundamentally are places where people agglomerate. Because of reasons that they have to come together to share resources, to match their needs, to learn. You know, why does learning happen? You know, I remember when I came to Delhi for the first time in 1998. Then I had come here to stay in a place called Jia Sarai, which is near IIT Delhi. And I used to stay there and prepare for my civil service exams. And all of us were there because we had the same goal to crack the civil service exams. And we were here to learn from each other. I mean, being in a group like that gives you, and that really helped. So cities are always going to be places where people will come for various reasons, as I said. These are just examples. Now, having said that, what is your social consciousness? If you want a society which is only focused on profits and focused on global competitiveness at any cost, then you will have a society which is slightly vulnerable. And especially in times like this, you've seen how the clear divide between the haves and have-nots has actually come out in society. And therefore, the cities of tomorrow have to, you know, be built with a more inclusive, more equitable, and by the way, a more competitive nature also. So, you know, you have to absorb and maybe do away with a lot of freebies that come to various segments and sectors, and actually, you know, focus on outcomes. Take the harder route. In fact, the simpler route is to give free money. Instead of that, you have to actually focus on giving money only based on outcomes. Give freedom, but also build incentives which make them do the right things. And, support cities. Instead of doing things yourself from the center in the state, I think more of supporting cities, more of building local capacity, championing local solutions. And these are simple things, but very difficult to, difficult to implement because they change the entire paradigm and they change the way you think. And all of us know it's easy to change what you have in your hand, your mobile phone. You can change almost every day. But changing your culture and your mindset may take even a lifetime or more. So that's where we are.
So there are a few questions here on our screen from the people who are watching here. And also some people are asking on the Facebook, which I am like getting on my mobile. So I'm selecting some of the questions. So someone has raised a question about how important is pollution monitoring in the smart city framework.
So I talked about the climate smart cities assessment.
Yes.
And within the climate smart cities assessment, there are five verticals. And one of the verticals deals with ambient air quality. So there are indicators where we monitor cities now on how their ambient air quality is. And then we learn from each other and also from global best practices as to how to improve that. So that's a very vital component of our program.
Okay.
I'll be brief in my answers because I want
Yes. There's another question regarding how important, important is the bicycle lanes in this perspective, and I am like taking it because environment has become an important topic after the COVID crisis. So you want to talk about it a bit?
And let me explore beyond bicycling to call non-motorized transport. Walking is also there, bicycling is there. Why has cycling not picked up? The biggest reason is lack of security, safety on the roads. If I feel safe cycling on the road, I'll be able to take up cycling because clearly for 2 kilometer, 3 kilometer kind of stretches, it helps me keep fit as well as gets me to the destination quickly and feels pleasant if it is a good evening and a nice thing. I remember something which I came across in Amsterdam when I was there for a visit. It says from sport to transport. Normally what all of us think of cycling is sport. But they say, when cycling turns from sport to transport, then the real revolution in public bicycling in the city and making it a cycle city. So I think safety is very important. So cycle lanes at the moment are not very safe, and let us not be very critical. We are in the process of learning. No country overnight, you know, starts to learn all these things. And I think Smart Cities Mission will get it right. We will make it sure that within the time period that cities are trying to work on their plans, they will get at least some of their areas with good cycling lanes. When I say good cycling lanes, I don't mean good looking cycling lanes. I mean safe cycling lanes which serve the purpose of cycling. And by the way, from the next week onwards, we are intending to launch a 6 to 8 week webinar with cities, where we are looking at sharing global experts coming and talking to them, and not sharing global perspectives, but looking to what cities in India are trying to do and helping them in cycling, in walking systems to improve them. And that's going to be one of the most important areas of work.
Fantastic. This another question about will in the next phase of the smart cities, now the COVID-19 lessons will get incorporated and health will be given a bigger focus, this question?
Yeah, so health and education, I think time has come that they get a separate, dedicated funding and administrative focus altogether. And this is not because of COVID. In fact, it has to be like that. And we don't have to link them to, how do we link to certain things which are basic to us? Food. We link shelter as basic to us. We link clothes as basic to us. I think time has come that in the administrative parlance, health and education become part of that kitty of things, which, and by the way, good quality. Even if public sector provides for education and health, it should be of such quality that it becomes a benchmark for the private sector. And so the private sector struggles to meet that benchmark is what we should be able to make out. That's one. The second thing is, about adaptiveness. So how do you build a dynamic urban planning frameworks, which then helps you understand the needs of the city as far as these sectors go, and so on. So these are multiple things that we have to start to think going forward.
There are questions like you have already addressed, so I'm skipping some of it. There's a question called, can smart cities also promote smart procurement? Isn't it time to move from traditional urban technique? Your opinion, please.
110% if there is something like that. I call it, in a single line, I call innovate procurement to procure innovations. And we are working on it, but it's a larger issue. Let me tell you that the central government, even if it comes out with some guideline or a rule according to its view, procurement is handled by the state government laws. So it becomes very challenging for us to influence, because every state government has to change its laws to move accordingly. But there are plans going on in our program for innovation that we are trying to come out with to support cities. We are coming out with clear guidelines on how innovation in procurement should happen, so that we become better procurers of, and especially with the kind of people we have, the smartness and the agility and the innovation that we have in our fraternity. It's Indians who are going on building Dubai's and Singapore's and the London's of the world. If we are able to procure our systems better, I think we'll be able to use that same brilliance for building our own cities here.
There is a question on are there any provisions under Smart Cities Mission on upholding slums in the cities, because there are a lot of issues to increasing slums. I think slum is an issue. How do we address that?
Yes, so slum is an issue which has happened because of a lot of different things. Land use patterns, our planning regulations. Then, of course, the lack of a market for housing in the bottom of the pyramid. And also housing for the migrant labor. And when I say migrant labor, there's a lot of confusion which is there between the traditional urban poor and the migrant labor. Look, the traditional urban poor you find in some slums are third generation, fourth generation. We had actually done a survey of street children in Pune. We found that there were third generation living on the roads of Pune. So there are those, and some of them are migrant labor which come for the 3 months, 4 months, do something, then go to another city and go somewhere else and all that. So there's a rotational labor also. So one very clear program we are going to come forward with is how do we rebuild through private participation or government efforts, how do we help in upgrading the slum settlement. So we're looking at about over the next 5 years, at least 20 to 25% of redevelopment of slum settlements, which will be a big push. Then of course, we are looking at other means. Let's not only focus on buildings. Let's not only focus on building houses, but also on focus on basic access to services. Mm. If you're living in slums, you at least, till the time you get a good quality building, you should at least get good quality water, good quality sanitation, good quality education, good quality health, which is where the access equality thing that I talked about will come in. Mm. So those things will come only when we are able to look into the reimagining aspect I talked about. How do you finance these services? So you look at financing it from means which are generated within the city and then flowing it back to actually create this level playing field. And by the way, these are investments. These are not expenditure. But people are healthier. You know, there was a time in the early 1900s when this company Ford, which is the first company to manufacture a car. So Henry Ford used to pay his workers $5 an hour when the going rate in that locality was $1 or $1.5. He used to say, if I pay my people well, they will be better taking care of themselves. They will be investing in other things and they will be, you know, creating a better economy, and my cars will eventually get bought because of that. So we have to look at these expenditures as that kind of investment. We are building a society which is more resilient and being able to participate in the overall economic activity, economic engine that cities are supposed to be. So there are these programs about the migrant labor, the program about helping entrepreneurship in the poor, the self-help groups program. There are certain programs about innovation where we will involve skilling with slum youth, and then online education, better health, better housing. These are the programs that we are looking at in the future.
There is a question on will the smart cities number go beyond 100? Are there any plans?
Here I will just tell you that don't look at smart cities as one city is smart or the other is not smart. Smart cities is like software. What is the difference between a hardware and a software? If you have a hardware called a mobile phone, you can only have that piece because you don't have an. But the same software can go into 100 different hardware, right? So look at smart cities as software. So when I mean software, don't look at digital technology. Software is any kind of learning where how to do things. Smartness is more about how to do things rather than what to do. What, by the way, will change from one city to another. Some city will be focusing because the needs of every city is different. So the what's will be different. So the how's are what smart cities are. And there's no worth, taking an experimentation from 100 cities to 200 cities. Now is the time that we actually, over the next 2-3 years, when we will be working with these cities, we will create the learnings which will go across to all the 4,000 plus cities in the country. But to answer your questions, the next version of India's smart cities should not be 100 or 200 or 300. It should be actually all the 4,000 cities in the country.
Excellent. And I think there is a related question that what are the knowledge management strategies that are being used in managing smart cities?
Yeah, a very good question. In fact, we of course have the SmartNet. Then we are now creating our own systems. In fact, we created some systems where a lot of the documentation of best practices happens. There's a lot of sharing which happens. Mm-hmm. India Smart City Awards that are every year given also encapsulate the best practices of that year, and some of them get awarded. Then we have newsletters which come out every week, which we share with a lot of people, which also goes on our website and the SmartNet website and the NIUA website, which also talks about what happened over the week. And then there's a lot of documentation about, the kind of citizen engagement that is happening, the kind of citizen engagement that happened in the past. So all those records are there with the ministry, and those are shared with all the partners. And there is a lot of, intellectual material which also gets created because of our partners. So we have created a long list of partnerships. In fact, only in our Climate Smart Cities program, we have 27 different local and national and global partners. So that's how the knowledge gets created, and then it's shared with everyone and keeps building because knowledge is something. It's not like you give to someone, it will be consumed. It's actually like a candle. You light another, you can light another candle with it. So knowledge grows with sharing.
Sure. And I can take a last question if you allow. Like we are already delayed, but the question around: are there any guidelines on the convergence project? If you can briefly talk about it. Convergence.
Well, the guidelines were very clear. Okay. Don't look at things in silos. Mm. You are solving a problem of a sanitation in slum. There are certain things you can do from smart cities, you can do from Swachh Bharat Mission, you can do through local action, you can do through municipal budget, you can do through NGO support. So convergence is what? Convergence is getting together the strengths of the local ecosystem, creating a whole which is greater than the sum of its parts. So convergence is a big part of our strategy, not only on implementation, but also on financing. So you can get part of the project financed through PPP, part of the project financed through raising money from the market, part of the finance from some tax revenue which you keep aside, which is called tax increment financing, and from the budget, from grants. So these are things that, in fact, 21% of our projects in smart cities are PPP projects. Over the last 3 years, so starting from Pune, we've had about 3,000 crores plus raised from the municipal bond market, which we are intending to take to at least 50 more cities over the next 5 years. So there are lots of plan about getting convergence in resources as well as implementation mechanisms going forward.
Okay. So with this, we will like to end this session, and I would like to thank Mr. Kunal Kumar for joining us for a very enlightening session. And I will request your views on our initiative at ELITS on creating awareness about governance projects to larger citizens, this effort of ELITS, your huge chronology and suggestions. If you can mention, that would be nice.
No, my suggestion to you would be, keep talking to the cities. And the more you have your eyes and ears on the ground, the more you know what to do. So you would not need to ask me.
Yes. Great. So with this, we close this session, and I thank all the audience and Kunal Kumarji for joining us here. And I request all the audience, if you liked this session, please like it and share on the Facebook so that this idea of the smart cities reaches to larger citizens, and they get aware about how the government of India is really trying to reform and reimagine our cities. Thank you, Kunalji. Namaskar.
Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.